Today, we're going to be speaking some more about rocks. So kung naalala nyo, last week, I gave you rocks to throw at me. But this week, I chose to not give you rocks because takot ako. Today, we want to talk specifically about what is the rock or who is the rock. Because I believe that as we read our Bible, sometimes we come across a passage or a word or even a name of someone or something na medyo malabo. Or minsan, kapag hindi naman tayo lumaki sa church, yung mga terminologies is something that is a little bit unusual or something that doesn't really make sense. So today, I want to tackle with you the term, the rock. No, I'm not talking about Dwayne Johnson. No, I'm sorry. I'm not also talking about rock music. I'm sorry, we're not speaking of Hot Dog or Queen ngayon po, pasensya. But today we are talking about the rock that is found in the scriptures. And so I want to take you down this path. I want to share with you and with all of us this concept of the true and this living rock. But beyond that, I also want to share with each and every one of us how we can truly trust in that same rock. Okay, so today, if you would, open up your Bibles to the book of Exodus. And we're going to read a little bit of this passage, Exodus chapter 17, where we are first introduced to this concept of the rock. And as we go there, let me share with you the first point that we're going to tackle. The first is this. The rock is the one that provides my physical needs. The rock provides my physical needs, okay? So if we're in Exodus chapter 17, let me give you a little bit of background of what's going on here. Moses was here in the wilderness with the Israelites. This was after they had exited Egypt and after they had already begun to wander around the wilderness. Now, there was a promise. Israel, the people of Israel, were promised to go to the promised land, a land flowing with, the Bible says, flowing with milk and honey, a beautiful land, a land that God had prepared for his people. However, his people, the Israelites, were complainers. What's the word in complaints in Tagalog? Reklamo. Mareklamo talaga po sila. They were frustrated. Maybe they were just tired of wandering around. They were thirsty. They had been whining about their situation. They had been taken out of being slaves and were brought out to this wilderness to eventually make it to the promised land. But God had some lessons that he wanted to teach them first. And this was one of those lessons that God wanted to show them that he, God, as the rock, was the one that could provide for all of their needs. You see, they had been wandering around, and finally they were complaining, hey, listen, Moses, you're the leader here. You're the boss. You're the one that's receiving the instructions from God. So our complaint is we're really thirsty. And hindi lang complaint. They started verbally just binabatoan nila si Moses with all of these complaints, and their biggest complaint right then was that they were thirsty. Really, you're going to take us out of Egypt where we had water into the wilderness? We're going to die of thirst? Have you ever experienced dying of thirst? No, you're still alive, but you felt it, right? Have you ever been outside and uhaw na uhaw ka? Sobrang alikabok ang panahon, sobrang init ang panahon, that you just feel like you're just going to die of sheer thirst. And you know that you're really thirsty is kapag meron kang nainom ng tubig, pawisan ka agad. Kasi naubos talaga yung tubig sa katawan mo. Na-experience niyo po ba yan? Ang saya, no? No, it's frustrating, it's difficult. And more than just being hangry, which is gutom at saka hangry, this lack of liquid in our bodies, it affects even our attitudes and skews our perspectives on reality. So in Exodus chapter 17, verse 5, we see here that God gives an instruction, and it's kind of weird. It says, and the Lord said to Moses, go on before the people and take with thee the elders of Israel and thy rod wherewith thou hast smote the river. That same rod that you hit the river with, he said, take that in thy hand and go And behold, I will stand before thee there upon the rock of Horeb, and thou shalt smite the rock. So I want you to take your stick, your walking stick, and I want you to hit a rock. What would happen if you hit a rock right now? Masasira ang stick mo. Yung pampalo mo, di ba? Bakit? Ang bato nito ay malaki. It's just a huge rock or a boulder, if you will. And God instructed Moses, go and hit this rock. And then, what does it say? And there shall come water out of it that the people may drink. And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. Moses went and hit this rock, and this water came out. And it's interesting, this water that came out was basically life-giving water. Baka hindi nyo po alam, yung katawan natin, we have to have water. If we don't have water, we will die. If we don't have food, we can last for 3 to 4 weeks. Pero kung wala po tayong tubig after ilang araw, mamatay po tayo. But looking back on this story, we can see these people of Israel, they had all of their basic necessities. Do you know what the basic necessities of humanity is? Every human must have air, right? Do you think there was air in the wilderness?
Siyempre.
Have you ever been to a point in your life that there was no air? Oo, kapag nalubog ka sa tubig. So, buti na lang, hindi po kayo naiwan na tatlong araw dyan sa ilalim ng baptismal pool. Mamatay ka. But they had plenty of air. The other need that every human needs is food. God was providing food for them through manna and the quail. God was providing their physical needs. Every human needs shelter. Tama po ba? We all need shelter to be protected from the elements. And they had that. They had their tents with them. We need safety. Every human needs to be safe, yes? Because if you're not safe, you will die. Ganun lang. Tama? Tama. They had safety and protection. God had already been protecting them from even the armies of Egypt. They needed sleep. Every human needs sleep and rest, right? You need sleep to survive, right? If we don't have sleep, according to psychological studies, mababaliw po tayo. Have you ever gone without sleep for 24 hours? Ang saya. Mga estudyante, overnighters, diba? Even the next day, it's a difficult day. We need rest, we need sleep, and they were given rest. They need clothing. Every human in the world needs clothing. And God, even though walang tindahan po dyan sa lugar nila, God allowed their clothing to not wear out. Even yung sapatos nila, hindi nasisira. Na-experience nyo po ba na siraan yung sapatos ninyo? Oo, yung sapatos ay parang naging alligator. Nagaging ganyan. I've experienced that. Oh, sa loob ng basketball, ang saya. Oo, ang hirap tumakbo kapag nasiraan yung sapatos. But God provided all of these needs and even He provided this water in the middle of the wilderness. And God showed to these Israelites that God was willing to provide even their physical needs. So question, are our physical needs being met? Yeah? Do we have water and food and shelter and clothing and air? Yes? I hope so, but I believe that God wants to bless us with more. No, please don't misunderstand me. I'm not talking about this gospel that's giving you everything that you ever wanted. But God provides all of our needs. So, the question is, are our needs being met, our physical needs? Let me share with you several verses that are found in the Bible. Proverbs chapter 10, verse 3 says, the Lord does not let His righteous go hungry. It says again in Psalms, young lions suffer from want and hunger, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. Again, we see in Matthew, now in the New Testament, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Further in the New Testament, we see again in Philippians 4, verse 19, and my God will supply all your needs according to his riches and glory. But notice inside of all of these that were stated, all of these verses that were quoted, we see that there's a qualifier. It says, the Lord does not let the righteous go hungry. It says, those that seek the Lord lack no good thing, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. You see, there is a connection between our needs being met and our relationship with the Lord. Nakita niyo po ba yan? Inside of these verses, they support that concept that we must have a relationship with God, an active relationship with God, in order for him to go ahead and put his hands on us. Now, the people of Israelite complained. Do we complain sometimes to God? God, I don't like this phone. Nokia 3310 pa rin. I need a new phone. Samsung S10 Plus. I need a new car. I need new dress clothes. I need. Pero sa totoo, yan mga bagay na yan, yan ang mga wants natin. Tama po ba? Those are things that we even desire. Where there's nothing wrong with wanting things, but when those things consume our lives, that's where we run into the problem. And God can choose to bless us with physical items. He can. But it comes down to, in meeting our needs, we need to be in right standing with God. So self-check. Are we in right standing with the Lord? Do a heart check. That's on you, not on me. I can't evaluate every person here. Actually, hindi naman responsibilidad ng mga staffers dito ma-check yung puso ninyo. Unless doctor po kami. May mga doctor, pwede naman ma-check yung puso kung tumitibok. Pero ang heart status natin sa harapan ng Diyos, that falls within our relationship between an individual and the Lord. So check, is our heart right with God? If I'm not living righteously, pure, clean, away from sin, guess what? It's time today to confess and turn away from that sin. Simple lang. Why? Because we want to be in right standing with the Lord. We want to be in a proper relationship with the Lord so that we can be assured that he will be providing all of our needs. Second is this. The rock protects me from harm. The rock protects me or even shelters me from harm. You see, in Psalm chapter 94, if you would turn there, Psalms chapter 94. Psalm chapter 94, verse 22. Psalm 94, verse 22. But the Lord is my defense, and my God is the rock of my refuge. He is the rock of my refuge, a safe place, one that gives protectance, one that defends us. If you want to have a fort of defenses, you want to have walls made out of stone, right? Or would we rather have walls made out of bamboo? That's not effective. The greatest wall that was ever created is not the wall between the U.S. and Mexico. It is called the Great Wall of China. Have you ever heard of the Great Wall of China? The Great Wall of China is made out of what substance? Stone, rock, because it protects. It is a barrier between its enemies. And that's what the Lord is to us. He creates that barrier, that protecting wall between us and our enemies. God is our rock. In 2 Samuel chapter 22, it says, the God of my rock, in him will I trust. He is my shield and the horn of my salvation, my high tower and my refuge, my Savior. Thou, God, the rock, saveth me from violence. God is supposed to be our rock. He is supposed to be our defense. He is supposed to be the one that protects each and every one of us. So question, are we being protected? Because, you know, we can still be protected even though we are being attacked. Did you know that? We can still be protected even though we are being attacked. How can we say this? You know, when you talk about security guards, when you talk about those that go into war, into battle, those that have shields, especially in the times past, they would carry a shield and they had a line of defense even though they were being attacked. Our God is the one who protects me from harm. So am I trusting God to be my shield? Because 2 Samuel tells us that God of my rock, in him will I trust. We must trust in our protection, the one that gives us that protection. So am I trusting God to be my high tower? Ask that to ourselves. Are we truly doing that? Are we truly going to God and seeking him out to be our refuge, our security? Am I trusting God with everything in my life? Let's check. Let's ask these hard questions. Am I trusting God with my spiritual life? Yes or no? If the answer is no, not yet, my friend, maybe you need to accept Jesus Christ. Or maybe you have fallen away from the Lord and it's time to get right again with God. So our spiritual lives need to be protected by God, because guess what? Dito sa loob ng buhay natin espiritual, there is an ongoing battle every single day between the armies of Satan and the armies of God. At naglalaban po yan araw-araw. And they are fighting for us. If you are a believer, your soul is saved. But your effectivity may not be. Because Satan can steal away elements of what we're trying to do by making us get sidetracked and focusing us on things that are not of worth. Are we trusting God with our finances? Oh, teka lang. Pag-usapan ng finances, akin po yan. Walang spiritual dun. No, let me tell you, my friends, if we trust God with our finances, he will be the one to make everything work out. We'll talk about that a little bit more in a moment. Are we trusting God with our promises? That we will hold true and fulfill our promises? May talata naman dito sa Biblia. It says, let your yes be yes and your no be no. But yet we still promise. Sino po ba dito nagpangako na po kayo? Kahit saan? Sa inyong anak. Yes? Anak, kung magiging mabait ka, mamaya meron kang Jollibee. Right? What about the harder promises? What about the promises to our spouse, till death do us part? What about the promises to our children? Child, I will provide for you always for your whole life. Until you get married, then you're out of my house. What about the promises that we make to our dear friends? Friend, whatever you go through, thick or thin, I'm going to be there because I do love you as my brother or my sister in Christ. What happens when we get to the point in our lives that those promises become difficult? Are we still trusting God that we will fulfill those promises? What about our promise for faith promise? For our giving promise to the Lord? Yung iba dito nagpangako, 500 pesos, linggo-linggo, nagbibigay pa rin po ba tayo? O kahit ano ang pinako natin sa Panginoon, hindi po yan promise sa akin, yan ang promise sa Panginoon. Are we fulfilling these promises and are we trusting that God, by faith, kaya naging faith promise, by faith, are we trusting God to provide those needed finances for us to give? Yes or no? Simple lang ang tanong, true or false, yes or no? Are we trusting God with our career, with our relationships? We can go on this list. Mahaba po ito. But it comes down to it. If we are trusting that God will protect our yeses and our noes, if we are trusting God to protect our finances, make sure that we have enough, that would change the way that we live our life, no? Because if we truly trust God, God, the creator of the universe, with everything inside of our lives, it would change the way that we function. Let me tell you something else about the rock. It not only provides for our needs, it not only provides protection, it also gives us solid ground. The rock gives us solid ground. In Ephesians, we realize that this rock that we are speaking of and the one that is being alluded to or described here in the Old Testament by Moses hitting this rock, we see in action Jesus Christ. And it says here in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 20. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 20. Go ahead and turn there. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 20. Ephesians 2, verse 20. Let me read that to you. It says here, and are built on, let me read verse 19. Now therefore, ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God. By the way, if you are a believer in Jesus Christ, you have put your faith in him, ask him to save you. You are part of God's family here. You're part of God's household, as it's reading there. We are fellow citizens with the saints, and are built upon the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. Jesus is the rock that we are built upon. Jesus is the rock that our eternity rests upon. Kung wala po si Jesus, baliwala po yung ginagawa natin. Kung wala po si Jesus bilang foundation stone natin sa buhay natin, our lives would be in shambles. We need Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. We see here in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Turn there if you will. 1 Corinthians chapter 10 verse 4. 1 Corinthians 10:4 It says, and did all drink the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. This was speaking specifically about Moses and the Israelites back then in the Old Testament where we just read. It's speaking of Jesus Christ. It was foretelling that Jesus Christ was going to be the one that not only was going to be the rock, but he was going to give us that water, that living water that quenches our spiritual thirst. My friends, we need the rock of Jesus Christ in our lives. If you do not have Jesus Christ in your heart right now living, my friend, today I would ask you to ask Jesus Christ into your heart. If you are living in such a way that is not right with God, my friends, we need to come clean with God and say, God, listen, I've been living wrong. I might have been living like the Israelites and complaining, and that's not how I should be living. I should be living in a life straight and righteous with you. So, question. How can I stand on the rock of Jesus? Let me give you 7, but really short and sweet, applications. Okay? Number one is this. Don't depend on myself. Don't depend on myself. We live in a world that where we must trust, where trust must be earned, and it seems that there's kind of a short supply of that. But Solomon, who was very famous in the Old Testament, he wrote most of Proverbs, he explains that we need to trust in something greater than ourselves. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5. Those of you that grew up in church are very familiar with this. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Many of us have been hurt and many of us have faced disappointments, and sometimes we forget how to trust the right people. Have you ever been hurt in your life? Have you ever been lied to in your life? Has anybody ever been dishonest with you? Yeah? Then you and I are the same. And because of that, oftentimes, ang ginagawa natin is, fine, I won't trust you ever. Kahit sino man, I don't care how nice you are, I don't care how guapo you are, I don't care what your position or your title, I don't even care. I'm only going to trust this one person, me. Yun ang ginagawa ng tao, tama? And dahil po doon, we also turn that onto God and say, listen, I don't know if I can trust you because everybody else has all lied to me. So fine, I can only trust me. I can't trust you. But Solomon, in all of his wisdom, and he's described as the wisest man that has ever lived, said, trust in the Lord with all your hearts and lean not on your own understanding. And this is why in Romans chapter 11, verse 33, tells us about the depths of the riches of the wisdom and the knowledge of God. You see, our God, the depth of the riches of both the wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments. You see, our God is so immeasurable, we don't even have the ability to comprehend how great God is, especially when it comes to his wisdom and knowledge. Tayo, limitado yung knowledge natin. Sino po ba dito nag-aral ng elementary? Taas ang kamay. Tinapos mo. High school. College. Sino po ba dito nakakuha ng college certificate o degree? Taas ang kamay. Sige na nga. Oh, sino po ba dito nag-masteral? Nag-ilan lang kayo, ha? Sino po ba dito nag-doctorate? May isa. Saan ba yung mga doctorates natin? Isa? Wala na. Ikaw lang mag-isa. O, meron pa dito. Okay. Do you notice how even inside of our group, our education, our knowledge levels get smaller and smaller the harder it gets? Why? Because it's tough to come up with that. But our God has unlimited resource of knowledge and wisdom. So, should we depend on myself who's limited or trust in our God who is unlimited? Ako po, nasaan li po ako palagi? Pati sa mang inasal. Pangalawa, cry out to God. We should cry out to God. When we surrender to God and when we trust God wholly, we need more than just a commitment. Sometimes we just need to cry out to God and show our dependence. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 6 says, in all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your paths straight. We need to acknowledge him verbally, vocally, express to God, God, I need you. When we get to that hard spot in our life, we say, God, I need you. When we hit that roadblock in our relationship and we don't think we can get past it, we need to turn to God and say, God, I need you. When you hit that career path in your life that all of a sudden everything comes tumbling down, we need to turn to God and say, God, we need God. We need to cry out to him. The psalmist in chapter 55, verse 17 tells us that every evening, morning, and noon, I cry out to you. And the good thing is, he hears my voice. When we cry out to God, we can trust and know that God hears our cries. Have you ever been to that point in your life that you've been broken? Yeah? I've been there multiple times in my life. Parang wasak yung buhay mo. Oo, nakaranas ko din yan, kaibigan. And at that point in our lives, we need to turn to God and say, God, I need you. So, how can we stand on the rock of Jesus? We can't depend on ourselves. We got to cry out to God. We also need to run from evil. We need to run from evil. Evil is so enticing. It's so attractive. Why? Because it's trying to lure us away from our relationship with God. You see, the things of this earth, it tries to mess with us. It tries to break us down. You see, in 1 John, it tells us that we got issues with the desires of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and also the pride of life. And these three things become the reasons why we fall in our spiritual walk. And we stop trusting in God and we start trusting in these other things. Sometimes we trust in our finances. I'm just going to let you know, kapag namatay po tayo, we will not bring any finances with us to heaven. I don't care what you're invested in. I don't care how much money you have in the bank or in your walls. I don't care if you're invested in pesos, dollars. I don't even care if you're invested in Bitcoin. Lahat po yan ay mawawala one day. The economy will one day cease to exist as far as we're concerned. Why? Because this life will end and we will be faced with God. We're not going to bring any money with us. Nothing. So, we need to run from evil. Proverbs chapter 3, again, the wise man from the Old Testament says, "Do not be wise in your own eyes, but fear the Lord and shun evil." Turn away from evil. Walk away from evil. We don't need evil in our lives. We don't need to trust in the things of this world. Why? Because those things are built upon this, the world, broken, things that will not last forever. We need to run away from those things. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 22 gives us another admonition, if you would turn there. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 22. It says, "Flee also youthful lusts, but follow righteousness and faith, charity, peace, and with them call on the Lord out of a pure heart." Notice, we got to run away from those youthful lusts, those things that entice us, and trust in God. Is it easy? No. It is simple, but it is not easy. Have you ever done something that's simple, but that's not easy? It is so simple to ride a bicycle. Have you ever fallen off a bike? Sino po ba dito hindi marunong magbisikleta? Hindi kayo marunong? Sino po ba dito marunong? Napakasimple, no? Pero napakahirap. Lalo kapag nagsimula po tayo, it takes trust that you gotta take those pedals and start moving them, and after you move them, it works. It's similar in our life with Christ. When we start trusting in God and we start walking down that path, we can trust and it becomes simpler. But if we get off the bicycle, if we get off the path with God, it sometimes takes a little bit of effort and trust again to get back on. When we fall into sin, we walk away from that path. When we fall into lust, we walk into that off that path. We need to come back into that right path with God by running away from evil. Another thing, we must put God first in my life. We shouldn't depend on ourselves. We should cry out to God. We should run from evil, but we should put God first in my life. Can we do that? It's easy to put ourselves first. It's easy to become me-centric. It's easy to be worried about our own ego. But Proverbs chapter 3, once again, I love coming back to the book of Proverbs. Alam mo kung bakit? There is so much wisdom jam-packed into each and every verse. Proverbs 3, verses 9 and 10. It says, "Honor the Lord with what? With thy substance," or with thy wealth, "and with the first fruits of thine increase," of all thine increase. And then verse 10, it says this. You got verse 10 up there too? "So shall thy barns be filled with plenty, and thy presses shall burst with new wine." Listen, we got to put God first. And when we do, when we put God first, it changes even our personal economy. When we put God first, even through our finances, it changes our economy. That's why we encourage every one of us that are believers and members of our church to give our tithes. Why? Because it engages God's economy. We'll talk about that another time. Why do we encourage everyone to take part in Faith Promise? Because it engages God's economy. Why do we encourage everybody to, on your own time, find a place to volunteer? Because at our church, every member is a minister. We want everyone to do that, because when we do that, it engages God's economy. We want to engage God's economy, but the only way that we can do that is to truly put God first in my life. Number five, we must check ourselves, or check myself, by God's word. Why do we need to check it with God's word? This is why. Because we are faulty. Do you realize we're broken? Tayo bilang tao. May kakulangan po tayo. Napansin niyo po ba yan? Tayo bilang tao, we are broken. We are lacking pieces. We need help. Some of you might be saying, yeah, Pastor Cory, you need lots of help. We all need help. We are in a broken state. Habang nandito pa rin po tayo sa mundo, we are lacking. We are not fully complete. We are needing to be with God. We start that with rectifying that relationship with God by accepting Christ and then living out our life towards God in a righteous way. And when we do that, our life becomes more full and more complete, but still our body and our soul wage war against one another. We fight against ourselves. And let me share with you this verse. Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 9, it says, "The heart is deceitful above all things and beyond cure." It is broken. It is desperately wicked. The question is, who can understand it? Who can know it? Who can really comprehend our hearts? We cannot. Don't you love that saying, oh, just follow your heart. You like that? Napaka-sweet. Follow your heart. Yeah, just do what you feel is right for you. Gonna let you know, if we just do what feels right to us, we will live in a more broken world. Because all of our hearts are broken. What feels right to you might not feel right to you, or to you, or to you. When you do just what you want or what your heart wants, guess what? It's going to conflict with everybody else. So we got to check our hearts against God. God and God's word. This should be the basis of our life. This should be the basis of how we live. This should be the basis of what direction we should go, not how I feel. Because I'm going to let you know, some days I feel pretty bad. Do you feel bad sometimes? Have you ever gotten into a fight with your friend or your significant other, and then you felt like, oh no, I'm not a very good Christian? Yeah? I think all of us have done that. Or have you ever gotten so angry at the traffic? So angry. And then you realize, oh no, God might not love me anymore because I'm not controlling my anger. We might get deceived by that, but guess what? That's just your heart that's being deceitful and lying to you. Because guess what? Our hearts are deceitful. Our hearts is still broken. We need God desperately. And when we check ourselves against God's word, that's when we can get in right standing. Psalm chapter 119, verse 11, "Thy word have I hidden in my heart." Thy word, God's word, have I hidden in my heart that I might not sin against thee, O God. That is what it's saying. We need to take these scriptures and apply it into our hearts. We need to take these scriptures and read it daily. We need to take these scriptures and memorize it so it's here and it's here, so that when our heart begins to lie to each and every one of us, we have ammunition to say, oh, nope, that's a lie. God will forever love me. Up, I cannot continue in sin because, what, do I want grace to abound? No, that's not the way I want to live my life. Up, I have to let my yes be yes and my no be no. Those are ways that we can hide his word in our heart and allow it to live and play out in our life. Another one is to listen to the Holy Spirit. We need to listen to the Holy Spirit. When Jesus went back to heaven, he ascended back into heaven, he also left with us a comforter, the Holy Spirit, which indwells every one of us who believe. And when we truly believe on God, he sends that counselor. John chapter 14, verse 26, it says, "But the counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send to you in my name," that Holy Spirit will be the one to teach you all things and to remind you of everything that I said. I kind of paraphrased that, but I'm just going to let you know. When Jesus went up to heaven and ascended, he sent down to us the Holy Spirit. And that is the counselor. That is the comforter. That is the one who fills us daily and gives us those movements and pushes inside of our lives to do something. And we might not fully understand why, but we can trust that the Holy Spirit would guide us. We should listen to the Holy Spirit. And then finally, as we have stopped listening to ourselves, and when we've ran from evil, and when we have checked ourselves against the Word, and when we allow the Holy Spirit to move inside of us, then we should rest in God's love. We should rest in God's love. Because when we face the difficult world each day, we can sometimes wonder if God even cares about me anyways. Have you ever been overwhelmed like that and you start asking that question? Does God even love me? I mean, come on. So many troubles, so many trials, so many issues that's going on so far. I just can't even handle it. I can't even believe that God loves me. It's hard. Sometimes we wonder if God even cares. Sometimes the question of, why do bad things happen? Where is God when I need him? Solomon, in all of his wisdom, once again reminds us that God never takes a break or leaves us to fend for ourselves. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 12. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 12. We've been going to Proverbs a lot, and I absolutely love it. As total side note, if you want a reading plan of reading the scriptures, I challenge you, read one proverb a day. Match it to the day of the month, and I guarantee you, your world view would change. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 12. "For whom the Lord loveth, he correcteth, even as a father the son in whom he delighteth." Listen, God loveth us. God loves us. And because of that, sometimes he has to choose to correct us. I love my children. I have three adorable children. And guess what? Minsan makulit sila, minsan pasaway. And ang responsibilidad ko bilang isang loving father, kailangan ko silang sawayin minsan. Bakit? Because I want them to develop into the best person that they can be. I want them to understand the fear of God. I want them to also understand that their father, regardless of what action they have done, regardless of what sin that they have committed, regardless of what fight they have been part of, I want them to know that I still love them, but I also need them to know that there will be times of correction, and they need to be guided by someone greater than they are. So our God disciplines those who he loves. God loves us, so we can know that even though we might feel like a time of correction or discipline, even from God, we can know that God truly loves us. John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, should not die, but have that everlasting life." I'm going to encourage you, if you have never asked Jesus Christ into your heart and asked for forgiveness for your sins and asked him to come and save you from that eternal separation from him, it's time to do that today. And if you're here today and you have already Jesus Christ in your heart, but maybe through this message we have realized that baka may kakulangan pa rin ako. It's time to get right with God. It's time to live righteously before God and to stand on that solid foundation of God. Maybe it's time for you to recommit something over to God. I would ask everybody to bow your heads and close your eyes. Give you a moment of privacy. God knows your situation. God knows your circumstances. God knows what you have been facing in your life. And I'm just going to challenge you, my friend, because of that, have an open, honest, heartfelt conversation with God. Ask God these questions. Am I truly trusting in you, God? Am I truly trusting in you, God? If the answer is yes, then great. Do a heart check. Is there areas of your life that you're not trusting God with yet? Maybe it's in your finances, maybe it's in your relationships. It's time to ask God, God, please take this. I want to trust you with my life. I want to trust you with my relationships. I want to trust you with my finances. Or maybe you're here today and you do not know Jesus Christ as your Savior, and it's time to ask Christ into your heart. And in a moment when I open up the altar, I would invite you to step out of your chair and to come forward. Maybe there's a decision that you need to make today. To make that, I would encourage you to do that here in the front so that we can pray for you and pray with you. Or maybe you need to commit to get baptized like the two that got baptized this morning and follow and in obedience baptism as a believer. Or maybe you need to commit to any other thing, maybe full-time service. Maybe God is calling you to be more active in the church. Whatever that may be, it's time to trust God more. Panginoon o Diyos, salamat po sa araw nito. God, I pray as we open this invitation to this altar, God, I pray that you would move inside of our hearts, allow us to be touched, and open our eyes to the truth if we are truly trusting in you or not. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I would like to ask everybody to please stand. We'll be singing Just As I Am, that's song number 375. If you want to sing along, you can. But if God is talking to your heart, respond now on this first verse. I encourage you.
Just as I am with
you. Can just step out from your chair. Labas ka lang sa iyong upuan. Lumapit ka dito. Huwag ka mahiya, huwag ka matakot. Yung ibang kumakanta, hayaan mo lang sila. Kapag ang Panginoon ay nagsalita sa iyong puso, baka panahon na. Panahon na tanggapin mo si Jesus. Panahon na magtiwala sa Kanya. Tuos. Kayo po. God knows who you are. God knows how you are right now. And maybe it's time to respond. Today is the day to respond. I encourage you. Meron po ba?
We have men here that would take your questions, that would love to pray with you. If you need to ask Jesus into your heart, we have counselors ready and willing to share with you from the Bible how to have that trust in God and have life everlasting. Kayo ate, kuya, tatay, nanay, kahit ano po ang kalagayan ninyo, God is there. All we have to do is trust in Him. Baptism. Maybe you want to be a member of this church. Why don't you come forward? We'll share with you how to be a member of this church. Thank you very much. You may be seated.